If unwilling to rise in the morning, say to thyself, I awake to do the work of a man. Hello, everyone. Welcome to episode two of Commoners Honing All Disciplines podcast, A Day in the Life of the Average Guy. The quote I just read was by Marcus Aurelius from his book of Meditations. And it's a particularly important quote to myself because I have that quote on my wall and I look at it every morning. And whenever I don't want to get out of bed, this quote motivates me and pushes me out of the bed to do the work of a man, as he said. And also relevant to this topic, we're going to paraphrase a Bible verse.
Yes.
I want to I want to read that for you.
Yeah. So hi everyone. How's it going? It's Happy. And the Bible verse I'm looking at today is Matthew chapter 20, verse 1 to 16. And basically the verse is the story of a master who owns a vineyard and some of his workers. So he hires his normal workers at the beginning of the day. And as they're going through their day, he sees other workers that are out of work and he sends them to do work in the vineyard. The same things happen later on. Those people are out in the vineyard doing work and the master goes to the front of the vineyard and he sees other people without work. So he sends them into the vineyard as well. So now we have three different groups of people in the vineyard. And at the end of the day, the master goes out to pay them their wages and he pays them all the same wage. And the earlier workers obviously get upset because they think, well, why don't we get the same amount of the people who came later? And the master says, why, who are you to get angry at me for my generosity? You agreed to your wage. What I give to others is my choice. And I think the good way to look at that from the standpoint of an individual is the idea that just because you started later or earlier doesn't mean that you can't get the same outcome as someone who started before you, who's more experienced than you. You can really only appreciate someone else improving themselves as well as appreciating yourself being improved in comparison to your past self. It really, and if someone's surpassing you in something maybe you've helped them with, it may be a way to think, wow, that's so awesome. I'm very happy for them and proud of them. And at the same time, you might kick yourself in the butt and say, well, maybe I could be doing a little bit more. So it's important to not compare yourself to someone else in that sense. Only compare yourself really to yourself before you are today. Because you're just going to kick yourself in the butt if you're comparing yourself to someone else who may be gifted in other aspects that you really can't know the exact equality of you and someone else, because their whole life is different, their whole circumstances are different. So it's important that you take your own life and your own circumstance and your own choices into account. And with that, I think we'll head on to our new day. So
yeah, so each of us must make choices every single day, and it's literally thousands of different choices, which is why a lot of people talk about decision fatigue by the end of the day, and why your brain will actually wants to automate as many decisions as possible and form habits, is because it actually takes a lot of energy to make the thousands and thousands of choices that we have to make every day. But all these choices affect the outcome of your life by a lot, because there's so many of them, they add up. And they compound. Good decisions compound, and also bad decisions compound in the opposite direction.
And it also doesn't mean your life is going to be any easier or harder necessarily. It just means that if you're willing to put in more discipline, when bad things happen, when negative things occur, you have already formed habits that help you stay strong and reliable and confident and smart and resilient. The whole point of building habits is to build up resilience to potential suffering and to prevent potential suffering in the future from negligence, right? From maybe bad health things. Like let's say, for example, if you know you have bad genetics of diabetes, you'll probably try to start cutting out sugar as soon as possible, or limiting it and getting a healthy relationship with that food. Just for example, yeah. Right? It doesn't mean you won't get diabetes. It doesn't mean you will. It just means that you're doing what you can to prepare for it to happen. And if it does happen, you're probably going to be better off than if someone who was eating a ton of sugar and then they have to stop abruptly, right? So again, it doesn't make your life easier or worse necessarily, but it makes you able to handle your circumstances better. So I guess let's begin with waking up. What's the first thing you do when you get up in the morning?
Yeah. Most people probably reach for their phone, but this is one of the worst things you can do first thing in the morning. And the reason for that is a total dopamine spike first thing in the morning is going to like set the baseline for that hormone for the rest of the day. So you're not going to want to do anything else that gives you a lower amount of dopamine because it's not going to feel the same. Right? Does that make sense? Because it's like if you ate a huge plate of sugary food like pastries or something, and then after you had to eat broccoli, you just wouldn't taste, you wouldn't want to taste broccoli after eating sugar because your brain is now expecting that higher level of dopamine. Yeah. So first thing in the morning, going on your phone sets you up for, I don't want to say depression, but it sets you up for a day where you're just not going to be in the right headspace.
Yeah, I think you're basically setting a baseline for your stimulation throughout the day. I don't think we may or may not be correct on the science here, and it doesn't really matter, to be honest. The whole idea is your baseline in the beginning of the day is just exactly what it is, and then when you use your phone, you're immediately stimulating yourself. You're stimulating your brain when maybe you're not even ready for stimulation. Maybe you kind of need to get up and yawn and stretch and just wash your face, brush your teeth, kind of let your brain wake up and let your body wake up with a little bit of moving, maybe a little bit of prayer to get your mind thinking about the day and maybe thinking about what you're thankful for. If you're not religious, you can do meditation, right? You can do yoga. You can get your body and your mind moving in a way that sets you up to be present in your day rather than just awaiting the next source of stimulation. That's definitely what you don't want. You do not want the first decision of your day to be what can make me the most stimulated, because guess what's going to happen? Every other decision you make that day will be towards your stimulation. And is stimulation what you want out of life or something else? If it's something else, then you should probably do something differently.
Yeah, exactly. And like you mentioned, some examples, prayer, stretching, exercise in the morning, all these things could be very good alternatives to checking your phone. And even like sometimes it's hard not to, like maybe you need to like check an email first thing or whatever. In that case, you could try to get up earlier before you need to check the email, just so you have a little bit of a buffer time. Or you could say, I'm only going to check email that one email, and once that's checked, I'm not touching my phone for another 20 minutes until I've done this other thing. Say to yourself, until I've done 20 push-ups, then I can go back and check my phone. Like small steps like that is going to make a huge difference. If you want to wean yourself off that habit of checking your phone. Another thing I'll mention is just to not have your phone within reach of your bed. I think that's, for me, that's huge. I have my phone across the room where it's charging. That way I can't even get to it from the bed.
Yeah, get a classic alarm clock. You don't have to use your phone to wake
up. Yeah, exactly.
Another thing is, one of your best friends might be a screen time a screen time setting where, like, during the week from like 10 p.m. or 11 p.m. to 8 a.m. or 9 a.m. or even 7 a.m., you're not allowed to use certain apps. So no social media, no entertainment apps, no nonsense on your phone, like, until you are woken up, right? Until you are able to, like, actually handle these things during the day rather than right at the beginning of the day. And you can give that, hopefully you have a friend you can do that with, or a sibling or a parent that you can say, hey, just put in the password and, you know, I'll come to you if I really need something, right? Like, let's say you have a day off on Friday night, just go to them and say, oh, let me, give me permission for the night. It's not that big of a deal. I use it a lot. I think it's really helpful. Like, there are tools that you should definitely look into. Like, don't just say, oh, no, this is too hard, I'm not going to do it. Like, no, try it. Mm-hmm. It's not going to hurt you to try it at least for 3 days. And if you're finding it beneficial, then you should definitely keep doing it. I found it very beneficial, just that one. And not only for the morning, but for the night. But we'll get into the night after. I think that's good for the morning. I think we'll move on to your morning routine, your breakfast routine, let's say.
Yeah. I will talk about getting dressed, because that's another important decision that you got to make first thing in the morning. Unless you've set your clothes up the night before, which a lot of people recommend, because then you're using yesterday's decision willpower and not today's decision willpower. That saves you from having to make that decision, because it's already laid out. You just have to, you know, put the clothes on. That way, a lot of these minimalist guys or these really rich guys, they just wear the same thing every day for that reason. It's just to simplify their routine. I'm not saying you have to do that, because looking good is important, and you know, your what you wear is obviously important. But if you set it up the night before, then you've just taken care of one more decision that you'd have to make in the morning, right?
Yeah, exactly. And that's obviously one of the extreme, right? Picking out the same outfit every day. It's also kind of boring, right? There's some things that, as you realize, you do have a lot of choices during the day. You also do not have a lot of choices in the day at the same time. So some people might actually relish in the fact that not only do they get to pick their clothes, but they get to pick what they enjoy to wear and their sense of fashion, their sense of style. They can add their own twist to it. Like, let's say you work in an office. You can be the guy who wears, like, polo every day and chinos. I don't know how formal it is. Or you wear a suit every day, right? You wear a dress shirt every day with a tie and a pocket square, for all I care. And it's up to you, really, right? Do you want a more casual look? Do you want a more professional look? It really depends where you are. Depends what you're doing. If you're a creative type, you actually might want a more out there look, and but while also being presentable, right? Or you may even want to look unpresentable, because that's your whole shtick. But again, this is an opposite side of the extreme. Chances are, if you're the average person, you want something that looks smart. You want something that looks professional, especially if you work in an office, if you work construction. You might have ripped jeans. You might have ripped clothes. Doesn't really matter. Unless you're in an office environment, really, that's where your average clothes, you just want to look smart. You want to look professional. Nothing too crazy, nothing too out there, right? Go nuts on casual Fridays, wear your Hawaiian shirts or whatever. I don't care. But picking your clothes beforehand is going to save you a lot of time. It's going to save you a lot of energy. If you change your mind, you can change it. That's fine. That happens.
Yeah.
But chances are, especially in the morning, you don't even want to make that decision. Your brain's like, listen, I'm just waking up. Give me some time to, like, get into it. And then you've already made the decision. So it helps with that day. Mm-hmm. So not making that decision, you might feel rushed. You might feel annoyed, right? Because you're like, oh no, what do I wear today? Should I check the weather? Like, there's maybe some factors you have to put into what you're going to wear that day. So definitely picking it beforehand is actually kind of a big deal. And knowing what looks good on you I think is very important.
Yeah. Yeah, so the next decision, or next big decision of the day, would be eating breakfast. Are you going to eat like food that's actually nourishing, or are you going to pick something that's like a Pop-Tart and it's just going to give you a sugar high, but you're going to crash, you know, halfway through the rest of the morning? Or possibly, we wanted to mention, you may be doing intermittent fasting or something.
Mm-hmm.
It would entirely depend on your situation. Like maybe if you work in construction, for example, you need the energy and you can't just skip breakfast that morning. Totally understandable. You know, how much you do want to consider how much like macros you're getting, fat, protein, carbs, because carbs might run you out of energy faster. But if you had some high protein, higher fat, then you're going to last longer and be full longer. Mm-hmm. So all of that is decisions, and you know, each of those decisions is going to have an impact. So maybe another thing you want to have planned out and have ready to go from the night before, right?
Yeah, exactly. And obviously there's different benefits to all these things. So if your chances are, if you're working construction, some people naturally don't eat breakfast. They don't like it. Some people need it. I remember when I was working labor, I definitely needed breakfast because I just felt totally tired by lunch. But it wasn't something huge, just something small, like a slice of toast. Some days I have like a couple eggs. Some other days, like simple things like hard-boiled eggs are really helpful because you could boil a bunch and have them throughout the week. And it was pretty good, like eating a smaller breakfast beforehand, because you get a little bit of a boost and you can kind of last to lunch, and hopefully you don't have that crash early on, like Nordic was saying. Mm-hmm. And you know, you just have to figure out what's best for you, right? Everyone's body's gonna be different, and some people might like intermittent fasting, some people might hate it, some people might like eating bread in the morning, some people might like hating it. And some people might like eating protein, like bacon or eggs or sausage, right? Ham, something, yeah. Maybe some leftovers from last night. Like, it doesn't really matter. But it's all about what's best for you and kind of experimenting with that, right? But I think the biggest thing in this is knowing what you're going to do the day before, right? So a lot of these decisions end up being eventually over time building up habits, so you already have things set out for you so your days can go as smoothly as possible, right?
Yeah.
And a lot of this stuff is going to prevent you from stress, which is a total, stress is like the number one thing that's going to ruin everything. It will break your habits. It will make your decision making bad.
It'll kill you.
You feel rushed. It will kill you. Inevitably, it'll kill you faster than anything else. Almost anything else. And, you know, the better decisions you make, especially in the morning when, you know, mornings can kind of make or break you. And I don't think people think about stuff like this, but if you have a crappy morning, the whole rest of your day could be bad.
Yeah.
Like straight up. And that's a long time for it to be a crappy day. Like, let's say something bad happens in the evening. You've already had the whole day that's been decent. So your day is not mm-hmm. going to be necessarily as bad as if something crappy happened in the morning, right?
Yeah, exactly.
And maybe you spilled coffee on your favorite shirt in the morning. Yeah. Maybe you want to eat breakfast before you get dressed next time. You know what I mean? Like, it's a small decision, right? Or if you weren't rushing, you wouldn't have spilled the coffee, right?
Mm-hmm.
These small, small things that can add up to big, big things. You're already having a crappy week. And you spilled coffee on your shirt. Now you got to change your shirt. Now you're in a rush. And now you're late for work. And oh my God, what is your boss going to say? You're already late last week a couple times because of other incidences. Like, it adds up. It definitely adds up. And I guess that brings us into our hygiene, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so you can, like, obviously you have to be showered to be presentable, and you have to brush your teeth and things like that. Again, personal preference, like if you want to shower the night before, you can do that. That's no big deal. To save time in the morning. I don't know what most people do, but again, it doesn't really matter. A big thing is not being in a hurry because, like you said, if something happens and then that you have to take extra time, if you have the extra time built in, then it's not going to throw you off as bad as if you're already in a rush and then something happens and then you're more in a rush. You're screwed, right? Like, and that just being in that mindset, say, from to go back to your example, you spill coffee and the guy's stressed out now. Like, what's his boss going to say? Maybe his boss does say something to him, and the way he reacts is not favorable because he's already pissed off because he's stressed and, you know, his morning's going bad. Now it's going to be worse for him.
Yeah. And I also want to add back to hygiene, like, what does it mean to be hygienic? So one thing is you're clean shaven, or if you have a beard, your beard is trimmed, right? Your neck is completely shaved. You don't have a neck beard or anything. You're around your ears are trimmed. So if you do cut your own hair, you want to focus on cleaning up around your ears. The back of your neck is a spot that people look at that you might not notice because you're not looking at it, but people notice, people see things, and whether they can articulate it or not, they can judge a book by a cover in a way, right? If your fingernails aren't cut, that's something people will notice whether you like it or not. If your breath is stinky, that's something people might notice, right? So you want to make sure you're brushing your teeth every day and flossing at least once a week, because I know people have trouble flossing. Some people like flossing. Most people hate it. I hate flossing. So I try to
Yeah,
floss at
same.
least once a week. I brush my teeth every morning and every night at the very minimum. Make sure my nails are cut every, I would say, depending on the time, sometimes they grow faster, sometimes slower, but I would say at least once a week I cut my nails, toenails as well. I know most people won't notice this, but it just helps to keep you in the habit of being presentable in every aspect, right? Because
Yeah,
again,
because you never know.
you never
You
know
never
what's
know
going to
who you're gonna
happen.
meet, right?
If you spill coffee on your shoe and you take your shoe off and your foot is like gross and your nails are gross and just someone happens to walk by and you like got these gross, icky toenails, and it's like, A, you should feel bad about one, not taking care of yourself, and then B, now someone else knows you don't take care of yourself. So how's that going to make you feel? That's going to make you feel better? Probably not. So
No,
definitely being
yeah.
presentable everywhere on, like, basically everywhere someone could potentially see on your body, your toenails, your fingernails, your face. That's your number one presentable thing. Everyone looks to the face first, right? You want to make sure your face is obviously, your hair looks good, right? Hopefully you've experimented with haircuts and you know what looks best. You know what looks professional and smart on you. You know what you can do quickly or what takes time for your hair. You can clean up around your ears, or you have a barber that schedules you in so you can get it cleaned up every 2 weeks to a month. You know, cleaning up the back of your neck if you do cut your own hair, if you have a beard, making sure it's trimmed, right? Make sure it looks presentable, looks respectable, and cutting it in a way so it frames your face well, right? Cutting it under your jawline. There's a couple of videos that are good with
Yeah.
that. We'll probably link some for sure to help you guys out with that. And it's like these simple little things that could totally change your whole life, right? I know it sounds weird, might sound extreme, but I'm not kidding. There's a cute girl at your office and you want to ask her out on a date. If you look like crap, if you've gotten like a 4 hour sleep, you got bags under your eyes, and your hair's all messy, and your nails aren't cut, what the heck are your chances with that girl in the office? It's gonna be very low. Right, compared to if you're always on time, you're always well dressed or at least dressed smart, you know what your haircut looks best on you and you wear it well, you're well maintained, you're always hygienic, your teeth are clean, your breath smells good, you smell good because you shower before work and you put on a decent cologne, not too strong though, you put on something decent,
right? You take care of yourself. People notice when you take care of yourself, and it's honestly one of the bare minimums. I can tell you for a fact, if you smell bad to a woman, that's going to hurt your chances way more than maybe anything else. Number one is because it hits you right away if you smell bad. It hits everyone, right? No one likes when someone smells bad. This is our average office guy, right?
Yeah. Guys don't really, because guys don't notice it as much, so they're not really aware. But something I wanted to mention, because I know of a lot of guys who are, like, let's just say unhygienic, but they don't realize that that's a problem when it comes to women, because women will always, not will always, but they notice that aesthetic and that hygienic stuff more. Mm-hmm. And they're conscious of it all the time. Like, that's why women are constantly obsessed with beauty products, makeup, perfumes, things like that, because they're always thinking about it. Mm-hmm. Because to them, it's really important. So if you put in a little bit of effort in that area, women will notice. Like, I can promise you, they will notice. And they won't, they really won't consider a guy unless he does smell good. And it's really how it should be, because, like, if you don't have the awareness to put in that little bit of effort, why should she be considering you, right?
Yeah, yeah. If you smell bad, if your breath smells, oh boy, good luck, dude. Good luck. No one wants that. You trust me, you probably don't want it either, right? If you knew you smelled bad, would you want to keep smelling bad? No. So why even take the chance? Why take the chance, right? Wake up, shower. Hopefully you have some organic deodorant that's not too too many chemicals. Hope you have some organic, more organic cologne or more natural cologne, so you can avoid unnecessary chemicals, right? And something that smells fresh, right? Something that smells fresh, something that smells not too strong, not too weak, right? Because, again, it's interesting, but a lot of people relate memories to scent. And I know we're going off on a tangent about scent here, but it is important. So a lot of people recognize memories with scent. So if you always smell the same, right? You picked out a cologne you really like, you like the brand, you like how it smells, other people have complimented you on it. If you wear the same one all the time, people will notice that and they'll remember you for that smell. So it's kind of a weird way to keep yourself in people's heads with that smell, right? And to keep people remembering, oh, wow, he always smells nice, right? He always smells nice. It's a repetitive. So you build your own habits, right? And guess what ends up happening is your habits rub off to other people, whether they can articulate it or not, right?
Yeah.
And these are, like I said, it's a small thing that could potentially change your life, right? If people don't, let's say you work in a really big office, right? Maybe you're moving around all the time and you don't really meet with people one-on-one, but if they recognize your face and they go and they see you again, right? And they go, hey, that's the guy that always smells nice, right? Or if they're in an elevator with you or whatever, you don't know who you're going to run into. If you run into an exec, right? An executive, and you smell good and they compliment you. Oh, wow, you smell nice. And maybe one day you're looking for a promotion within the company. And they go, oh, I remember you worked on X floor, and wow, you always smell good. Yeah, you still smell good, right? Like, that's just a small example, but these are all potential things that can happen for the average person, right? And the same thing could happen with anyone. So it's very important to be consistent with your hygiene. I think that's enough about smells for now.
Yeah, that's good. But it's really important, though, for sure. Yeah. So next segment, I guess we could move into here. We're just going to look at, you know, an example of two different guys and the choices that each guy makes. One guy making good decisions, the other guy not good decisions. Mm. We'll go through the day and then we'll see. We'll just talk about how their life might turn out, right? So, guy number one, after waking up, he drinks a glass of water that he left out for himself. He says a short prayer. He does a set of push-ups, and then he brushes his teeth.
And then guy number two, I'll be guy number two. You can be guy number one. So guy number two wakes up, checks his Instagram, checks his DMs, no DMs, total loser. I'm kidding. Checks his crypto portfolio. It's not looking good. So he's already, morning's already off to a bad start. And then he goes to get a slice, to eat a slice of bread, and he puts on some Nutella. He feels bad, so he's going to eat a bit of extra Nutella, right? Let's see, he adds an extra tablespoon of Nutella. It's 100 and something calories right there.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, so he's going to be, his dopamine is now spiked right off the bat, and he's upset because he didn't get any DMs, his crypto's down, and he's also got a big sugar rush, right? So right off the bat, compared to the guy one, who's now hydrated, he's feeling at peace. He's feeling energized because he did push-ups. And he's more hygienic because he just brushed his teeth, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you can just see those two. Like, each of those things is like 15 minutes in the morning. And each guy made a couple decisions. And now, just after 15 minutes, where is each guy? Like, one guy's feeling way better right off the bat.
Yeah, and we'll get more into the details over time with each guy. So the next part would be
So guy one, he has his clothes picked out and ready, and he's not in a rush because everything in his morning routine is set up for him, right?
Yeah, and then guy number two has put on the same shirt as yesterday, and he forgot to put on deodorant. He forgot to put on his cologne, and because he was in a rush, because he didn't know what to wear, and he's looking for pants, and he has a couple pairs of pants on the floor. He picks one of them up, smells them, and they don't smell too bad, and he puts them on. So they're a little wrinkly. Shirt's a little wrinkly. He's got a little bit of an odor to him. Again, not necessarily bad, but it's not good.
Yeah. No, then guy one, he leaves for work or school on time. He wasn't in a rush. He's got an extra 10 minutes for himself in case there's traffic, and he's feeling calm.
Yeah, and guy number two, he's late, scrolling through his phone, checking his Instagram again, and jumps in the car, doesn't warm it up, goes right off to work or to school, just in the perfect amount of time. So if he's in more of a rush, he's more likely to get into an accident.
Mm-hmm. True. So guy one arrives at work. He walks in, he gets a nice smile from the cute receptionist as he arrives on time.
What did guy one listen to in the car on the way to work? Maybe we should say that too. What might
he listen to? Commoners Honing All Disciplines podcast.
Let's go.
Obviously.
Of course. Because
there's nothing else you would listen to.
Yeah.
Or maybe an audiobook.
Yeah, in the morning it's good not to listen to like comedy. Again, you don't want to overstimulate yourself, right? You're going into work. You kind of want to be calm going to work. You don't want anything crazy. You might want to listen to some music, some relaxing music. Again, maybe nothing too crazy. You might even want to listen to an informal podcast or just like a relaxing podcast just to get you just calm, just ready for work, right? Ready for the day, get you present.
Yeah.
Right. And now guy number two, listening to loud rock music as he goes in, and he rushing into the office. So he almost hits someone on the way and they give him the finger. He pulls in. Opens the door to the office, bangs it open, basically. And the receptionist, who gave our other guy a nice smile, gives him a dirty look because he's late, he's unkept, his hair is got a little wisp of hair coming out. Where did that come from, right? He was driving too fast with the windows down. Now his hair is a little crazy. And, he gets a dirty look, and he rushes into the elevator or up the stairs to go to work.
Yeah. Right? And maybe he was, instead of loud rock music, he could have been listening to the radio, the news, and he like heard all about some bullshit news, and it just got him in a bad mood and ruined his drive because he had to hear about whatever politics or shenanigans is going on, and now he's pissed off for that reason.
Yeah. Sports news isn't so bad because sports, you might have stuff in common with coworkers, which might be useful if you actually enjoy it, right? Number one is do not listen to something you don't care about, because that's going to, it's going to come across as inauthentic, and people do notice when people are inauthentic. So number one is, you know, listen to stuff that you enjoy and use that to find commonalities, right? And I think this segues into our next part of the day, which is lunch.
Yeah. Yeah, so guy one, he had a productive morning at work. Now it's lunch. He's going to interact with his coworkers. Since he listened to a good podcast or a good book on the way, he's got stuff to talk about. He's interesting. I have packed his lunch from home with I don't know what he could bring, but he's eating healthy.
It's maybe a
pre-made for himself
or something.
Yeah, exactly.
Meat and potatoes, maybe some pasta he had left over, right?
Mm-hmm. And he can obviously talk about work, a productive morning he had at work, because he was ready to go when he got there.
Yeah, and also it opens him up to be able to listen to other people, because he's not in his own self, right? He's not in his own head. He doesn't have to, think, "What was me? How crappy my morning was," right? But our number two guy, he's starving, right? He ate his Nutella. He's about to crash. His sugar, he's come down from a sugar high. And he goes to McDonald's, listening to his loud music again, not talking to any coworkers. He eats in his car. He watches like some stupid YouTube video in the car, right?
Yeah.
And, doesn't want to talk to people at work. And then he goes back to work and just, kind of finishes the day without really interacting with anyone. And just, again, his own head, alone, right?
And he's probably and wasn't.
And his own actions and his own behavior have also caused him to think that other people wouldn't want to be around him as well. So there's that double whammy of like, not only are potentially other people judging you, but you're your own harshest critic. So you know how crappy you've been that day, and you're going to treat yourself worse than anyone else might, because they don't know how crappy it's been that day. So again, these little things, by lunchtime they're compounding already, and that's only one day. So
yeah, and I was just going to mention the dopamine effect too. He didn't have as well of a as good of a work session in the morning or the afternoon, because he spiked his dopamine right in the morning. So he kept feeling the urge to check his phone all throughout the day when he was supposed to be working. So his production has gone down, which the boss is going to notice. His other coworkers are probably going to notice that too, because he can't stay focused on the tasks at hand, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and, let's say at the end of the day, the two of them are like, guy number one, he's had his work done, right? He's good to go. When he goes home, he doesn't need to worry about anything. Guy number two has to stay in late because he had a crappy morning and he didn't do enough work. So now he has to not necessarily work overtime, but he has to finish what he was supposed to have done already. So now he's staying later, right? So he's not going to have time to make dinner or go grocery shopping or whatever he had to do that day. So he's going to get another fast food meal. He might even skip his workout, right? Guy number one, he might go home. He's going to make his dinner, hopefully make something healthy, maybe have some leftovers.
Yeah, and I was going to say after work, he's got time. He goes to the gym, or he goes and maybe plays sports with a group of his friends for a social aspect, as well as a an exercise factor. So he's feeling good after work for that reason.
Yeah. And then guy number two, again, he's alone, has his fast food dinner, goes home, just goes right on his video games, or right to his, or right to porn.
Yeah.
Because he's had a crappy day, so he says, you know, what does it matter? I'm just going to do, my thing. He uses it to maybe make him feel a bit better temporarily. It doesn't work out. Guy number one, you know, he watches sports. He might get his lunch ready for the next day, pick his clothes out, read, and then go to bed.
Yeah.
Guy number two just is on his phone until he falls asleep.
Yeah.
And sets his alarm, then, and that's it.
That's the nighttime routine is huge because it sets up everything for the next day. If your whole morning routine is based on the idea that I don't want to make these decisions in the morning because that takes too much energy, then you really have to get the nighttime routine down. Otherwise, you can't really have a good morning routine.
Yeah.
Because you haven't set anything up, right? So with that, like guy number two, maybe his phone won't be charged now because he was using it all night and he forgot to plug it in before he went to sleep, right? Or maybe he forgot his alarm. Now it's going to be even worse the next morning, right? Versus guy number one, if he's planned everything out, he set everything up, he's just going to roll right into the next day, but it's going to be another productive day and probably even more productive because the good choices are going to compound versus guy number two with the bad choices. That's going to calm down. Maybe he wakes up late the next day. Now he's even more late for work. He's even more unkept because he doesn't have any laundry done. That's kind of the point we were trying to illustrate here, is that all these decisions have a snowball effect either for good or for bad. Mm-hmm. And you can see the effect of that just after one day. It's a huge difference making good decisions versus bad decisions.
And let's look at this. Let's potentially look at this over time. So if you want, can you give me guy number one at 1 week? Give me him at like, actually no, not 1 week. Give me guy number one at a month. Give me guy number one at the end of the year. And then let's say at the end of 5 years. I think those are pretty good. Like small. Yeah. And then I'll do guy number two. And it gets rough.
Okay. Yeah. So at the end of the week, guy number one, he's got enough confidence to ask out that cute receptionist who kept smiling at him. And since he looks good every day, he's happy every day. That is increasing his mood. Other people want to react to him. They want to be around him because of that mood. He gets to go on a date with her. Let's say a year, because of how his performance was at work and the way he was charismatic and happy all the time, his boss notices, and his boss says, you know, I want to promote you to like upper management because, you know, you're always in a good mood. You're always on time. You're always doing good work here. He gets a promotion. That's another life-changing thing. And you can look at it 5 years down the line. Maybe he's got a family. Maybe he married that girl. He's got, you know, he can afford a house now. He can afford to improve his lifestyle because he's had all these successes over the years because he's kept a disciplined schedule the entire time, right? And it was gradually improving him every week, every year, until he gets to that 5 years. And even, you know, 30 years, he's happy at the end of it because he chose to make good decisions.
Mm-hmm. Oh boy, you don't want to listen to what happens to guy number two. After a week, let's say guy number two probably gains a few pounds just from that week. Yeah. Has less motivation to exercise because he's pretty asocial or antisocial. He doesn't want to hang out with people. So he starts drinking alone. And because he's drinking, he focuses even less on work. And let's say eventually after a year, they notice and they just fire him because he smells, he's unkept and very unapproachable at work. Maybe even he's even picked up smoking by then because he doesn't want to actually work. He just wants to go out and take a smoke break every once in a while, way too often probably. Then he eventually gets fired, and because he gets fired, he gets put on employment insurance. And on employment insurance, instead of looking for a job, he just sits at home, plays video games, watches TV, and drinks. Then he continues that. And 5 years into the future, he's got no friends, he's got no connections, still on the employment insurance, still drinking his life away. And eventually, he goes drinking and driving one day because he doesn't care. He gets into a car accident. Maybe even kills someone. After he kills someone, he gets sent to jail for, I don't know, 5 years, let's say. I don't know how much it is. Maybe 15 years. I don't know. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now he's in jail. Now he gets nothing. You get no alcohol. He gets none of the food he wants. He can't watch Netflix. You can't play your video games. He's a total piece of shit. And he's treated like one in the jail. He is treated like one, definitely, in the jail. And even there, he's a bad life because of the decisions he's made. I think we'll end guy number two there because I don't want to go any further. Because to be honest, yeah, let's say that's one side of the extreme. It's fucking depressing, man.
Yeah.
It is sad. It is very sad the way people's life go. If they let themselves go, it's very, mm-hmm. very sad.
It can also be motivating to think about that too. Like, you don't want to be that guy. And you think about how good it could be. You look at guy number one, who is making it. He's fit. He's happy. He's got a family. He's got a promotion.
And I think all even that stuff. With guy number one, that's even a bit optimistic because, like, let's say the girl he goes out on a date with, they go on a couple dates. They're not compatible. It doesn't work out. Number one caring? He doesn't care.
He's confident.
Go on another day. He's confident. He's fine, man. He understands that, listen, there's you're one guy. There's millions of women. Do you expect to meet the right one right away? No. Is he going to stop trying? No. He's going to keep going. He's going to continue his good habits. Maybe he doesn't even get a promotion at work. Maybe they have a big layoff and he gets fired. However, his boss, because of his attitude, still really likes him. And you know, he says, you know what, I'll give you a reference, right? Like, we got to let you go because we're downsizing this department, but I'm going to give you a letter of reference. And you know what, please tell anyone you're interviewing with to give me a call and I'll be very happy to refer you and help you get a job there. So he's more likely to get hired again too, right?
Yeah.
He might even have people who's, and this is like 5-10 years down the line, he might have people who quit the same office as him, who he eventually goes to work for or start a company with. Because they're willing to work with him because they remember his attitude. And if he still has that attitude, then he can continue it, right? It's this compounding effect. Mm-hmm. And the biggest area that I believe all of this stuff impacts is your connections with other people.
Yeah.
Because
that's a good point.
Your connections with other people, and this is proven, the richest people in the world, the most successful people in the world, have the best connections. Because the people they connect to other people as well. So their network, by the time they're like 50, is insane. They know people you probably couldn't even imagine, right? And what happens is it starts slowly and they just don't stop. And maybe they aren't perfect, but at least in that aspect, they're doing a great job because they know the truth is your connections, right? The way people view you and the way you view others, and the way you're able to work with others, right, and compromise and get things done which is what's necessary in any environment, really, that is going to be your number one asset. And how to support that is by supporting your own good habits.
Yeah. It's totally huge. That's why people say it's not what you know, it's who you know. Mm-hmm. Everything, like every job I've ever gotten has been because I knew somebody. I'm not trying to say I'm super in favor of nepotism, but it's kind of how the world works. Mm-hmm. And it's because that's such a powerful thing to get a reference from someone else you know. Say, yeah, I know that guy. He's good, right? You should hire him because I know he's a good guy. That's the main way that people get jobs. And you should take that into consideration as well. When you're in a bad mood, because if you, you know, rub someone the wrong way, you might get passed over for a promotion or something like that. Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. You so never know mood is huge. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. You could meet your future wife tomorrow. You could meet your future boss tomorrow. Another reason why it's so important to be, you know, well-dressed, good hygiene, because, meeting people you don't know, they don't know anything about you. So if you're the way you look, the way you act, that first impression will always stick with them. And that's who you'll be to that person pretty much forever. Obviously, you can change, but it's really hard to change. It takes more times meeting that same person and you being different to actually change their mind. Yeah, so even being guy number one, losing your job, you're still in a better situation because you made better choices, even when you're down on your luck, right? So he didn't start drinking after he lost his job. He probably found another job, or he started a company because he had that good reference, right? Mm-hmm. Guy number two would never get a reference after he got laid off.
Or maybe even started a new career, right? Because that's never out of the question. He might have even said, you know what, I have a bit of money saved and I can do this. I can go back to school for an MBA or something, right?
Yeah,
there's always true. For the person who is consistent, there's always options.
Mm-hmm.
Because that the thing about consistency is it seeps into all aspects of your life. Your ability to build habits and maintain them, your discipline, right? Your will seeps into every aspect of your life and needs to be trained. It needs to be honed.
Yeah, that's a good point. Everything, every decision you make is connected to every aspect of your life. One thing I want to talk about before the end, it's definitely related to these decisions, is the concept of being an active person or being a passive person. So everyone's familiar with the NPC meme, and essentially that's the personification of the passive person. And what I mean by that person just kind of coasts through life, and they just kind of let things happen to them, versus the active decision maker. This guy, he decides, okay, I'm going to go to college. I'm going to take this major, right? Instead of like the attitude being, well, my parents want me to go to college, so I guess that's what I'll do. And I guess I'll take this because, you know, it looks cool, right? Or I guess I'll move in with this girl because we're already dating and that's what people do. Instead of saying, I like making decisions, saying, I like this girl, I'm going to move in with her, I'm going to marry her, right?
Mm.
Like, you see the difference with those two mindsets. The guy who's active in those decisions, he's going to get more fulfillment out of life because he's more accountable. He has more agency. And versus the guy who just kind of lets things happen, he doesn't really have control. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it ends up coming down to your discipline allows you to control the things that you can control, right? So like we said before, no matter what circumstances are thrown at you, you're still able to bounce back. You're still able to have that resilience and the attitude of the bounce back, right? The continue forward mentality, right?
Yeah, so I thought we could give some like actionable advice here about forming routines and forming habits. So what do you do when, like, say you start a new semester and your schedule changes? Like, what's your process for getting into a new morning routine?
So for me personally, I obviously write down whenever a class is. I have my calendars or whatever. I get those in order first. The next thing I'll do, obviously, is gauge a time where I can get up every day at the same time, and that would be consistent. So let's say I have two classes in the day that start at 9, two classes in the day that's in the week, sorry, in the week that start at 11, and then one class starts at like 2 p.m. Am I going to get up at a different time on all of these days? No, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to probably get up at 8 p.m., assuming these classes are online, 8 a.m., sorry. Assuming these classes are online at this point in time, I'm going to get up at something like 8 a.m. I might do a little bit of calisthenics. I like doing calisthenics in the morning. So if I have an arm day that day or like an upper body day that day, I like to do push-ups and I like to do dips and I like to do some pull-ups in the morning. Just enough till failure. It usually takes about 5 minutes, 5 to 10 minutes, not even. Goes by super fast, right? And I only do one set and that gets me woke up in the morning. And then I'll go brush my teeth. And I usually put on my workout clothes right away. I'll go brush my teeth. And then I'll go into class. A lot of the time they're on Zoom, so you don't have to look presentable. That's fine. I do, though, however, still like to keep my nails, again, once a week, like I said, at minimum. I clean my neck beard if I have one, or I shave if I'm fully shaven at that time. I switch back and forth. It really depends. I do cut my own hair, though, so when I do trim my beard, and when I have one, I trim around my ears, I'll get a mirror, I trim the back of my neck. I do that about once a week, sometimes twice a week. If you're going to go on a date, I definitely recommend doing it fresh, just before you shower. Yeah. That's a nice thing to do, is cleaning yourself up, making sure your nails are trimmed, you know, cleaning up that little space in between your eyebrows. That's a nice thing. Tweezers, preferably in between your eyebrows. Just in between, though, I will say. Because anyone else is kind of girly.
Yeah, don't get carried away.
Don't get carried away here. Just do right in between, nothing else. Your eyebrows are weird, that's fine. No one cares, really. As long as the middle is not a unibrow, right, you're pretty much good to go. And so that's what I like to do. After I wake up, right, obviously I don't eat breakfast. I intermittent fast, but I always drink a whole bottle of water right in the morning, and then I'll refill my bottle and drink it throughout the day and just keep refilling it. I probably have a minimum of four bottles of water a day at least. And obviously I'll do my classes, right? If I have one class in the morning and I have the rest of the day off, well, I'll make a nice lunch or I'll eat leftovers. I'll read during the day, right? I like to schedule things around eating. So let's say I have lunch at 12. And then say, okay, I'm going to go on a walk because I like to go for a walk after I eat to digest a little bit. Go for a 10-minute walk. I'll walk my dog, right? And then I'll come home. I'll read for maybe 20 minutes to half an hour. And I usually like to read in my backyard. I like to read in the sun so I can get some sun while I'm reading. Kill two birds with one stone. And after that, I'll probably work out again because it'll probably be around 1:32. Or I'll do some more homework, and then I'll work out just before dinner. I'll do my full workout. I really don't use weights too much anymore, but when I do, it's usually half an hour, right? I don't kill myself. If I do cardio, I usually do it beforehand. I like to get my blood pumping, and I like to do shadow boxing, as cardio is really good if you don't have a treadmill. Just moving around, right? Practicing the movements, kicking, punching, like dodging, as if you have an opponent in front of you who's slowly trying to attack you. And obviously over time, you can kind of increase your imagination and use combos and see you know, things at work. But this is, again, this is just cardio. It's good warm up. Walking's fantastic. If you can, if you have the time for like an hour walk, highly recommend it. And then if I have a second class later that day, I'll do my second class. I'll have dinner. Again, I try to go on a walk after I eat to help digest. It's pretty good for you. Helps with the gut microbiome, supposedly. And then I have the rest of the day to myself, right? So by 8 p.m., I've worked out, right? I've showered, and I can just game, or I can chill out. I can hang out with friends, you know, whatever I'm going to do in that evening. And that's what I like to do during the week. I can go visit family members, you know, because that's nice when you have that time to yourself and you kind of say, okay, that's good. I've done what I need to do today. I can relax. And before I go to bed, I usually read, again, 20 minutes, 10 minutes of my book of choice, right? And then I usually do 10 minutes of the Bible. And then that's pretty much it for me. That's kind of like my daily routine. What about you? I know you were working pretty recently. So what is your work day routine look like?
Yeah, so if I go to work, I'll start off with this. At the beginning of the week, or the end of the week on Sunday, I usually do it. That's like I plan out the week, each day, what I need to do that's important for each day, and then roughly structure it, meals, things like that. So if I'm going to work, I usually have to get up pretty early, like around 5 a.m. I'll have like my clothes ready, my lunch ready. I usually don't eat breakfast. Mm-hmm. So all I have to do is basically get up, get dressed, brush my teeth. And yeah, like I said, I shower the night before, so I don't have to do that in the morning. Because I kind of like to just get up and go, especially when it's that early. Then I spend a long time at work because I usually work like 12 hours. Then come home. So it's not really like I have that much to plan. When I get home, I usually try to get a workout in, which is either a session of weights or a session of boxing. I try to kind of stagger those. So one day I'll do weights, the other day I'll do boxing.
Nice.
Off and on. And days where I don't work, because I don't work every day, it's kind of like, it's hard to describe, but construction, it's just kind of like they call you when there's work, and if there's no work, they don't call you. So
yeah.
The off days, I'll plan out the day and make sure I get at least 4 hours of solid work on my my side business. So I'll do wake up in the morning, have breakfast, kind of read for about half an hour, then start work for about 2 hours, take a break, have lunch, do a workout, which takes about an hour usually. Then it's actually that point I'll shower. Then I'll get another 2 hours of work done, have dinner, read a bit in the evening, or just do whatever I want, and then go to bed. And just before bed, set up like my breakfast, my lunch, my clothes and stuff for the next day. So it's kind of it's hard because I don't know when I'm going to work, but kind of like that as well, because it keeps the schedule changing. It doesn't stay static, which I do like. I like experimenting with the schedule, figuring out what works. So for that reason, I'm constantly changing it, because my schedule is constantly changing in what I have to do.
Yeah, but at least you right, like you at least have those habits. So even if you don't do as much on some days, like you kind of stick to the schedule and, you know, make sure that you're still doing the things that you need to do every day, regardless of like whether you're working or not, which is really important.
Yeah. Yeah, it's definitely useful, like, to look at it based on what do I need to get done that's most important. And then I'm thinking about before that day even comes, I've already thought about roughly how am I going to lay out this day that is going to be most effective. And with more, the more you do that, like, I think I've been doing that for, I mean, I have stopped briefly, but I think I've been doing that for the last 4 years since I was in school. So it's become such a habit to just plan the week. And I sort of a good quote. I can't remember who said it though, but he basically was one of the American generals from World War II, probably Patton. But he
Probably.
said, "Planning is everything, but plans are useless." And it's so true because
So true.
you can never follow a plan exactly. It never works. There's always going to be something that changes. But the act of planning puts all of those scenarios in your head already, puts everything that you need to get to accomplish in your head or on paper, and then you can just follow through with the spirit of that plan rather than the actual letter of the plan. That's a quote I really like.
Yeah, that is good. I think that's very relevant. And yeah, definitely something to look at in terms of your life, right? Like you can make plans, but you make plans and you hear God laugh, but you have to still plan, right? You have to still be planning your own life, right? If things don't work out, the whole point is that you're able to adapt. You've built up that resilience from these habits that you've built. You've built up the discipline, you've built up the common sense, hopefully, to change and adjust your own life in order to adapt to circumstances, right? And that's just going to benefit you in every aspect of your life, really. And honestly, I think that's pretty much it I have on this topic.
We can close it up here.
I think I'm good.
So I'm just going to read a closing quote. "Industry, lose no time. Be always employed in something useful. Cut off all unnecessary actions." And that's from Benjamin Franklin. So some resources we have here at the end for you guys. First one is from the Art of Manliness. There's a video called How to Plan Your Week. So I'll put the link in there. And basically, that's the method that I use to plan my week. And I use a similar schedule as well that I made based on that video. And the main idea is, like I was saying, you set out the most important things first, and you put those in first, and then you fill in the rest of your time.
And also add a video about trimming your beard properly so that it looks nice and even underneath your jawline and it really accentuates that. So
It's a good idea.
I think that's it for today.
All right, thanks for listening, guys.